visions in my head. People tell me that I'm crazy. I tell them that's exactly.
Okay, so really glad that you're here. I feel like we've already hung out for so long. Yeah. It's been about 5 minutes.
I know. Literally, I already know you.
Yeah, we're already
Thanks
here.
Thanks for having me.
I'm so happy you're here. Thank you. Oh, also, we are recording a podcast, a show for hers as well, which yes, I probably already said on this intro, which I'm very excited. Down. Yeah, we're busy. We're booked and we're busy today. Yeah. Speaking of, I want to talk about work ethic with you specifically, because Morgan Yates, I know that I've heard like three different things with you, people being like, Morgan Yates says you're the hardest worker she knows.
Oh, that's so nice of her.
I just want to hear your daily routine. Oh, like, that's what I want to get in, like, very specifics, like what you do. If there's like podcasts that you listen to or books that you've read or people that you really look up to, I need to know everything.
Yeah, well, first up, I feel like we live in this social media crazy world where you always have to be busy and stay on top of it because we don't have a boss. And so we have to push ourselves to be busy and create our own schedule, which I think is almost one of the hardest parts about starting what we do, because no one's telling us what to do and no 100%. One's giving us a schedule. So we have to create our own schedule. And it's taken me a while to understand how to create this calendar for myself. I still struggle with it because every single day is different. But what I like to do is have full content days. So tomorrow will be a content day for like my own digital stuff, like my app and my Instagram, my YouTube. And then Thursday is like my studio day for my show. And so like I have to really make sure every day is for the same topic and focus on one thing.
Yeah, I love doing that.
Yeah, so every day really is different. So when someone says, okay, what's your daily routine? I wake up at the exact same time every day and go to bed the exact same time.
Wait, okay, go into that. Go into like morning and night routines and exactly when you wake up.
Okay, so I wake up at 6:45 every morning, and I go to bed around 11, I would say, every night. And my sleep routine is so important to me. Besides on weekends, on Friday and Saturdays.
This is where I'm really failing, because I will go to bed at 9 p.m. on a weekday and I'll wake up early. And weekend, I got home at 4 a.m.
Oh, yeah.
I had a flight. Like, what's wrong with me? Yeah, I'm so messed up from it. Yeah.
Yeah. And so weekends, like on Saturday night, I went to bed at 3:30. So it's a little different there. Yeah. And it takes me a while to get back into routine, but I have to have that routine of like going to bed and waking up at the same time, because I'm by the way, huge girl on sleep. Like, if I don't get my sleep, I'm nothing.
Do you have like the Aura ring or anything?
I actually am getting it next week. That's so funny you said that.
I am considering ordering it. I was thinking about it today. I'm like, do I just buy it now?
My mom is obsessed with it and checks it every day. So I'm getting it next week. Funny you said that.
Emily DiDonato came on the show. She's a model.
Love her.
Yeah, she was telling me, she's like, Kenzie, you need this. Because I kept talking to her about sleep and stuff. She's like, no, you literally have to buy the Aura ring. That's what you need.
Yeah, okay. And it's like so subtle.
Yeah, it's really sleek.
So it's perfect. But yeah, wake up at 6:45 every day. I am a morning workout person. If I wait till the afternoon, I lose all dedication, all interest, and I'm so freaking lazy. So I have to work out in the morning. And then honestly, my workout in the morning pumps me to like be really busy and productive. I don't know if you feel
the same way. I
completely agree. But working out makes me more productive.
I have to get movement in the morning or else I'm just not productive at all. I will literally get half of what I would get done versus like if I worked out, I would get double.
100%. Yeah. So, yeah, and then I just get started, whether it's computer work, whether it's filming, whether it's doing workout videos or editing. I edit my own videos.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask.
Yeah, I edit my own videos right now, which I am looking for an editor.
Yeah.
It's hard. Do you edit your own videos?
Half of them.
Okay.
I don't edit any of the podcasts, so, like, that's the best part. And then I edit my own vlogs, but I don't edit any sit-down videos or anything like that. But I'm so vlog-heavy that I feel like I kind of need to give that over soon. But it's just so hard with vlogs because they're so much more personal to me that I just feel weird.
That's the hard thing I'm struggling with right now, is giving up a little bit of my business.
Yeah.
I need help and I need someone to help me, but I'm sure you feel the same way. Like, what we do is like us and our brand is us. And so it's hard to have other people helping sometimes.
Especially, yes, I have a very hard time with giving things up. Like, I keep saying I'm going to hire someone else. I already have one person who edits and does so many things, but that's like virtually remote, not virtually, whatever, same thing. But I struggle with that. And then on the vlog, and two, I'll have like other people in my life in the vlog, and I know what they're okay with and what they're not okay with.
Yes.
So that's my other control thing with it. It's like, oh, they wouldn't want this and I'm cutting it out, you know?
Totally. And the time it takes to explain to someone what I want is the exact same amount of time it's going to take me to edit it.
Yeah. So it's this never ending cycle, because long term it would 100% make more sense to explain it and hire them.
Totally.
But
in right now where I'm thinking, I'm like, absolutely not.
Right. Yeah. I completely agree. So I'm sure you can agree with me as well. Every single day is different. And that's what makes it so exciting. And I think that's also why I can continue to work so hard, because yeah. every day is different and exciting. Don't get me wrong. There's days where I literally don't work and I don't want to do anything. Like yesterday was a Sunday and I did not even touch my phone, and I need those days that are completely off social media as well, to kind of make sure that I'm never really hitting that plateau. But yeah, every day is different, and especially when you're doing something that you love, it is so easy to stay motivated.
Yeah, it's so much easier.
Yeah.
Do you have a time that you start work every day, or is it all over the place?
Man, I shoot off emails by 7 a.m. sometimes.
Yeah.
I'm the annoying one. And
I'm on the treadmill and I'm doing emails sometimes. And yeah. I'm like, this is probably not healthy.
No, yeah. not at all. And I wake up and No, it's not. I get really anxious about how many emails I have. Because 100%. Sometimes I finish work at like 4 p.m. the night before. And my management company likes to send emails at like 8 p.m. sometimes. Yeah. And I'm like, there needs to be a cutoff time for me, because I can be the type of person who can work at like 10 p.m. and
yeah.
my boyfriend gets so annoyed with me, like, okay, get off your phone, we're enjoying dinner. And so when I wake up early, that's when I feel definitely most productive. I work hard, but I finish work at like 4 p.m. every day. I really do.
Yeah, but that's like fine. Yeah. I also think that people are so obsessed with the concept of being busy.
Yes.
And that doesn't, busyness is not necessarily even productive, but it's also doesn't equate to success. So I'm always asking people, I'm like, what do you do, especially when we do similar things? Because we have to set it up ourselves. So I'm always like, what's your routine? How do you do this? Like, how do you handle emails? How do you, just certain random things?
Yeah.
Because if I can learn a small thing from someone else that's going to save me an hour a day, I'm going to do that. You know, I don't need to, you don't need to be working from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. every day at all. And also, I think half the time that's actually counterproductive.
I have recently become super against hustle culture.
I'm so against it.
Yeah.
Yes.
And,
yes.
And some people, like, I actually used to be this way, so I'm really contradicting myself. If you,
me too.
If you followed me since like 2018, you're like, you were like this. But I would wake up and I'd be like, I'm doing this today. I'm traveling here. I'm doing this. I'm so busy. I'm good. And like, I wasn't really, what's my end goal here?
Mm-hmm.
And it would just create more anxiety for me. I would get, you know, like, honestly really lonely at times, because I was just working
it's
so
really
hard
isolating.
And really isolating, especially us, we work alone most of the time. And so I have really tried to create more of a balance with my life, which sounds so obvious, but I think in our 20s it's very hard to kind of realize what's important, what you need to focus on, and we're all in such different, you know, areas of our lives in our 20s, and just figuring it out. And so I'm really happy that I'm in a spot right now where I can say I work really hard, but I don't work like insane hours.
You don't like live to work. Like,
no, yeah. no. And like, you know, you have to realize what actually matters in life. At 100%. The end of the day, are you going to be remembered by your career? Absolutely not. You're going to be remembered by how people, you know, how you made people feel. And mm-hmm. so that's what I've really tried to take back. And honestly, probably shouldn't be saying this, but this last year with everything going on with the pandemic, it really taught me that. And I'm thankful for it.
I say all this because I was the same way. I had a really unhealthy relationship with work for a long time, and it took me probably 2 years to really get to a place where I feel like I actually have healthy boundaries and I can guard my mental health at the same time, because our job, it's honestly, it's not even the hate on social media, nothing like, it's really not that. It's the not having structure and being alone all day that kind of will make me go crazy.
Yeah.
But that's all I did for so long. It's all I cared about. And same with me, like now, especially this year, I'm like, I actually want a life again. Like I'm home, I'm with my friends that I've had for forever. And now I actually am like going out and I'm living life as like a normal 23-year-old. And for so long, I thought I was 40, you know? So now
are
I'm like
23.
Yeah, I'm 23.
You are a baby.
Every time I say this, I'm always the youngest of everyone around me. Even earlier, they were like, oh my God, you're only 23. I'm like, you're only 24. Like, what do you mean?
I'm 27. And I'm like, 23 is like, whoa, that's really
It's young. Honestly encouraging though, because I feel like with social media at any age, and I don't think this about anyone else, but I'll be like, I'm already 23. And I've only recently switched to I'm only 23.
Right. Because I think someone like me as a 27-year-old, and I see all these like TikTokers who are like 19
oh my God.
And making millions and like millions of followers, I'm like, oh
my gosh, I am so old. And
it's crazy.
I literally said it to like some of my older friends and they're like, are you kidding me, Katie? You're only 27. This is insane.
Yeah.
But in my perspective, in the social media world, 27 is like, whoa, you're really old.
But you're not. It's just this weird mind game that I feel like we'll probably always, I don't know, maybe this isn't just a social media thing. Maybe this is across the board and we just don't know because we just talk to people in our fields. But it is, I think it's just like, something that you're always like putting in the back of your mind.
Yeah.
Especially when you're like a high performer and you want to achieve, it's really difficult.
Completely agree. Completely.
I want to talk about SI though. Congrats, by the way. That's so big. So what was the process? I love the TikTok of you calling your mom. I was going to cry. It was so sweet.
Thank you.
How does that even happen?
Okay, so basically Sports Illustrated swimsuit came out with swim search. It's hard to say. Swim search in 2017 was their first open call. And basically, if you don't know what that is, never before it could be open to the public. You have to have an in-person casting, like through an agency. This was the first time 4 years ago that anyone could apply online. You send in a video, you post it online, you take part in like their challenges online, their hashtags and everything like that, and you make a video on why they should choose you. So I did this first in 2017. And I obviously didn't get it. And I continued just to like try to be a part of the brand for a very long time. During quarantine and COVID, I actually did all their live workouts every Monday for almost 10 months. I did a live workout on their platform. So while doing that, I was auditioning for Swim Search. And so I made a video. And this time, before my videos, my audition videos were literally just like me talking to Karen, like, hi, here's why you should pick me. This time I went all out. I hired a videographer. Like I edited the video. I made a whole entire script with it to really show my personality. And I played sports in college. And so I basically made it like a really sporty video because I'm also a sports host as well. That's like my background. And so I decided to make a video, went like hard on it. And I first had that idea last July 2020, posted it August 2020, finally got the call that I got it March 2020, shot with SI, with UTSI, May of this year. And now walking in Miami Swim Week in July. That's and our crazy. Launch is end of July. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. That is so exciting.
That's the process. And there's obviously so much more that goes into it.
Yeah.
But those are just kind of like the dates and everything. So it's a really long process.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's been really, really exciting.
That is so exciting. That's huge. That's literally like you can't really go bigger.
Thank
you. Know?
You.
That's
Thank
incredible.
You.
Congrats.
Thanks so much.
I want to talk about being a collegiate athlete.
Oh, yeah.
I hear a lot of horror stories now.
Oh, yeah.
Especially from friends that I have. And I hear, I mean, like, they're in like intense therapy now. Like it's really, really bad. Did you have a good experience? Like,
no.
What was your okay? Yeah,
I did not have a good experience.
I literally don't know one person who has, and I'm sure I just am not talking to them. But you know,
I will say this: before I start complaining, I do want to preface it and say I am so grateful because my mom would kill me if she heard me say this, but like I did not get into USC on my academic. I was a really, really good lacrosse player. And so I'm very thankful for that because, you know, I was good at sports and that's how I got into school because I was on scholarship. And I did play lacrosse since I was 7 years old. I also want to say that because you know what? You never know at the USC these days. You know
like,
what I mean?
No, seriously.
And people are like, what do you mean by that? You didn't get in. And I'm like, no. I meant I was really, really good at lacrosse. So that's how I got in. You know what I mean?
You're
so
like,
grades weren't, you know, up to par.
But it was, you got in on your athletic scholarship that you played since you were seven.
Since I was seven.
Your high school team was like top two. I saw you post about the other day.
Yes.
Right?
My high school team was always top three in the nation. And so basically, I've had run tests since I was 12 years old. Virginia.
Okay, cool.
So random. So I'm from Virginia, and I played lacrosse since I was seven. By the time I got to college, I was so burnt out, and I really hated my life. If you knew me in college, my freshman year, I literally, I say this not very lightly, I was depressed because lacrosse took over my life. My sister was a senior at USC, and I saw how much fun she was having at frat parties, like boys, like, you know, you're just get to college and I couldn't do any of that. I couldn't, my coaches wouldn't let me join a sorority. And so it was really tough because I already knew what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to be a sports host. That was like my end all be all. And so it was hard to put in 6 hours a day of a sport where it's not getting you anywhere. I understand for someone like a basketball, women's basketball, or, you know, soccer or tennis, you want to put in that work because you can become a professional athlete and make a lot of money. For me, I was like, wait a second, am I going to become a coach and make 40 grand a year?
Yeah.
What the fuck am I allowed to cuss?
Yeah.
what the fuck am I doing? I already know what I want to do. And I'm in Los Angeles. I'm from Virginia and I live in Los Angeles now. This is BS. And so I was really, really not okay. And it was constant competition, constant pressure of like who's starting and like, you know, and honestly, I was just really unhappy. And so I ended up quitting. And so I ended up quitting and I had, you know, 2 more years of college to be able to focus on what I really wanted to do. And I will never be more thankful that I quit my sport in college because I got to start like my career as a junior in college. Are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. Like that was insane. I had internships. I was at the sports broadcast show. If I graduated with not one thing to my name because I was so focused on lacrosse, I would have been years so behind. And so I'm really grateful I quit. And I know I'm not supposed to like say that I encourage quitting, but like it is
best. No, way. I think that's an important topic because it's not encouraged, you know? And not that we're telling you to quit, but I think it's just the broader idea of like different people have different paths and sometimes that's the right decision, you know?
I always think that you should be putting 110% into whatever you're doing. And if you can't give your sport 110%, I was also taking up scholarship. I could give my scholarship basically to someone that actually really wanted to be there. I didn't want to be there. I also had to take in account my mental health. Mm-hmm. Everyone around me knew I was unhappy and I wasn't sleeping and I had really bad anxiety. And so I was so happy when I moved on. I'm not gonna lie, it was really hard to find like, you know, a good friend group after that because, you know, my team traveled so much and I, you know, couldn't be as close with my lacrosse team. And then I joined a sorority way too late. So like it was like really hard to like find my place in college after that. But mental health was a huge part of it. A huge part. Actually, like 80% of me the quitting. Reason. Yeah.
It's just such an interesting topic because I think for so many people, their whole dream in life is to be a college athlete. And I never even thought about the fact that once you get there, so many people are unhappy.
Yeah.
It's just hard.
It's hard. It's really hard. And now, you know, I'm 27. So, you know, what was this? Like 8 years ago? You don't talk much about mental health.
Yeah.
You suck it up, you get on that field and it does not matter. Nowadays, I feel like coaches are a little bit more inclined to like ask you how you're doing and get a therapist and the school is like under a little bit more liability for mental health issues, which I'm so, so on board with. So that's great. But again, 8 years ago, that really wasn't the case. It was more like suck it up and be strong. And something that really, really messed me up was our training coaches. This is why I had so much anxiety is I would get to practice and practice was early in the morning and they wouldn't tell us what we're doing that day. So every day was a surprise. And that fucked me up because I didn't know if it was going to be a 6 mile run test, 300s test, or just a light lift day. Like I had no idea. So it really mentally prepared me for anything in life. I will say that, grateful for that mental strength, but at the same time, it's just not worth it for me.
Yeah, not your thing.
No, it wasn't my thing.
Yeah. And you made the right decision because clearly that worked out so well.
Yeah.
I want to talk about you and your mom. I love the content together. Is it cool that you're in like similar spaces?
So cool.
What was it like growing up with a mom who was like so into this world and like fit and healthy?
So normal and so nothing different than anyone would think because we lived in Virginia.
Yeah.
Such a normal life, even though my mom did travel, I would say once a month to film her show for a week. And so, you know, it was really cool growing up. And every time we'd travel or be in the airport or the grocery store, you know, women would come up to her and be like, you literally like saved my life. Mm-hmm. I'm so, so thankful I found you and you saved my life. You had me lose like 50 pounds, blah, blah, blah. It was very gratifying to watch my mom help other people so much. Just a side note, if you don't know who my mom is, she had her own TV show for 26 years. She holds the record for how many workout videos sold globally.
Wow.
And so she was a really real pioneer in the fitness industry. She was on Lifetime for 14 years, ESPN for 12, I want to say. And so she honestly, if you asked me in the beginning like about hard work, she is the one key to working hard. And I feel like it was really awesome to grow up with a mom who was so ambitious and so hardworking and telling me I can be successful in any industry that I want to do.
That is really cool. And also just entrepreneurial in general.
Oh, for sure. She created her own path.
Yeah.
So,
especially
you know.
Especially then.
Yeah, especially then. People she told people she wanted to, like, you know, have her own fitness TV show, and she got so many no's. She called the Today Show 48 times. Like, she literally was so ambitious. She created her own career. And so, obviously, having a successful dad really helps as well. But to have your mom mm-hmm. be so ambitious and entrepreneurial taught my sister and I, like, really hard work ethic.
It's also so cool because the industry that we're in is also so new, but she has really, like, pioneered a different wave. So I can only imagine, like, how helpful that has to be to have a mom that, like, gets it way more yes. than anyone else would, but also has, like, practical, tangible advice.
Absolutely. Yeah. That is so cool. And it's also just cool to have my mom, you know, a fitness legend, be so much of my best friend, but also a mentor to me mm-hmm. and, like, introduce me to so many people. I will say the only bad thing about following in her footsteps is getting hate that I have it so easy. And so
I get that.
That's another driver that makes me work harder, because everyone's like, this, she's just doing exactly what her mom does, and you'll never be your mom. Like, good luck.
But that's also, while your paths are similar in the spaces, it's totally different.
Oh my gosh.
Like, so what different. You guys do is actually very opposite, you know?
Totally, totally. She had VHSs and DVDs. Yeah. And honestly, she'll admit it to this day. It was her, Jane Fonda, and Richard Simmons, you know? And mm-hmm. so there were, like, three to five fitness experts at her time. Literally, that is it. Fitness personalities. Crazy. How many are there today? 2 million. Literally. Maybe more. Maybe more yeah, fitness actually. Personalities. So there's so much more competition these days. It's crazy online.
Do you listen to any podcasts or, like, read any books or follow any, like, entrepreneurs, people in the fitness space that you really look to, like, something that's impacted maybe your, like, business journey?
I have to be a little honest here. I try not to ever really look at people in the fitness space. And I know that sounds like a little weird.
That makes sense.
But for a few reasons, I'll say this right now. If I see people in the fitness space, you know, doing really well, I don't want to get down on myself, A. And B, I don't really want to ever, in the back of my mind, because I'm so creative about my workout and my workout routine and what I say, I never want to subconsciously, like, accidentally copy them or, like, take ideas from what they're doing. Mm-hmm. Like, if I followed and actually, like, I actually muted, like, every fitness professional online. I'm sorry if you're my actual friend out there, but every fitness girl online is muted for me.
I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, because I never want to compare myself. I don't want to accidentally copy. I don't want anything to do with it. And not in a way that, like, I don't like them, because they're amazing people. I just don't want to compare myself. Mm-hmm. I just don't. And I think I'm vastly different. And so I just don't even want to get it. Yeah. I don't know.
I love that. Well, it's something I was talking to a friend about last night. I was just saying, I don't even really listen to people now who do similar things to what I do. I like learning from people in totally different industries. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I get more out of it, because at this point, I know pretty much everyone. Like, I've met them. I've yes. heard it. We all do the same thing.
Yes.
So I was like, I felt like a lot of it was not redundant in a bad way. Obviously, we're all just sharing our experiences and we have a similar experience, and I can always learn from the next person. But it's really cool. Like, even last night, I was listening to, on the flight, a podcast with Blake Griffin. Oh, and cool. It's like so random. Like, I just really like right now learning from people who do totally different things than I do.
Yes.
Especially when I'm in a space where I'm like, I don't know what my next move is. So I just want to hear everything.
I completely agree. And when I said that, I almost like feel bad saying that, because I truly do want to empower women. And I'm like, I'm not taking away from them. I'm also doing this and not paying attention to other people in my space because I don't want to compare myself. I don't want to like hurt my mental health. I'll be like, oh my God, they're doing this, they're doing that, I should be doing that. And so what you said is exactly what I do. Mm-hmm. I love taking inspiration from others who are not in the fitness space, because I also don't want to be so tied to the fitness space. My background's in sports broadcasting. I love so many other things. I love cooking recipes. Like, I'm not just a fitness girl, mm-hmm. and so I don't want to just be, like, deemed as that, and I'm trying to kind of get out of that a little bit.
Do you want to go back to, like, sports broadcasting? Yes. Like, more, okay.
Desperately.
So badly.
I had so many jobs before. I was on Fox Sports West for 2.5 years, and then I did the NBA Awards. I worked for NBA a while, and then I did overtime, and when COVID hit, I lost all my jobs.
Yeah.
And now I'm just a fitness girl because it hasn't, you know, come back.
I think
around.
You're more of a personality though. Like, I think you.
Kenzie, thank you.
That's what I was looking for. No, you're right. You share so many other things. I wouldn't just say like you're, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And I think that's probably, you would probably agree with me on this here. It is so hard to sometimes explain to someone what you do.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I don't. When I'm out with, and it's funny because most of who I hang out with, like at home, I've either known since like elementary school, middle school, high school. And if I haven't, they're like my friends, the growing up, they're best friends from college. Yeah. So look, everyone knows, right? And we'll go out and they'll be like, oh, what do you do? And I just will make up the most random job on the spot.
Stop.
Because I'm also in Texas. Like, I don't want, and like a lot of people have some sort of following or whatever in Dallas, blah, blah, blah. But like, I don't really know what to say. And two, nope. I don't want to be asked about it. No. So like, I feel like people ask me things. I'm like the least cold person ever. I'm really friendly, really outgoing, but I kind of like tense up because I just don't want to go into it at that point. So it's like a weird thing. But also on just like a practical level, I'm like, what do I do? I don't even know.
I don't know either. Yeah. And honestly, I could give you a 30-minute spiel of what I do or just be like, yeah, I'm a fitness personality and influencer. But then it's like, you don't want to demean yourself. Like, holy shit, we do so much and so many things. And I think it also comes a place of insecurity of me. It truly does, because I've always been like from home, from DC and everything, and like everyone I went to college with, and my boyfriend's in finance, and all my friends from home do like insane, like my best friend's going to law school right now.
Yeah.
So like when I go home and it's like, so what do you do? And I'm like, I'm an influencer?
Yeah.
What the hell? It comes from a place of insecurity. It does.
You know what I will say though is with the show, the podcast, saying host feels so much better and it feels so much more me.
Yeah.
So like things like that. And I don't really like pitch myself. Now it's like my team pitches me. So I'm like, what are you guys even? You know, I didn't realize that I was Gen Z for so long. I'm Gen Z.
You are. Yes.
And I say that very proudly. At first, I had a really hard time with it. I thought I was millennial my whole life and I wasn't. And the 12-year-olds on the internet are really coming at me because they're really mad that I'm Gen Z. There's like some dates that are up in the air, but I'm Gen Z. I had a phone charm. Like
100%.
I'm 100% Gen Z. But I asked my manager for something and she's like, Kenzie, I literally pitch you as like our Gen Z talent. And I'm like, wait, what? I had no idea. So this is what I'm saying. You know, who knows at the end of the day?
Yeah. I'm also very jealous you're Gen Z.
Oh my god, Gen Z is taking over the world. At first I was like, this is like cringy, and now I'm like, please, like I am here.
Someone called me a little embarrassed.
Someone called me Chugi the other day.
What's that?
Oh my god, it's like not cool. Old.
Oh my
like
god.
So I'm trying to think of something that would be Chugi.
I'm so old that I don't even know what that is.
Do you remember like when Alfred had the mustaches back in the day, like the Alfred coffee?
Oh yeah.
That would be like a really good example of something that's like Chugi.
Okay, oh my god, I'm so old, you guys. What?
Chugi. I mean, honestly, that just means you're not being bullied on the internet for being Chugi. Right now, you want to know why I got a new phone last week?
What?
Yes. I normally hate on the internet, and these things don't bother me at all. I'm totally kidding. I was at dinner with my cousin. I did notice my TikTok quality video, or my TikTok video quality was not the best, I will say. I was getting bullied by 12-year-olds on the internet.
No.
I went to AT&T the next morning at 9:01 a.m. The place opened at 9 a.m. I had bought a new phone.
Like an iPhone 12?
Yeah.
Well, oh, what phone did you
I
have
had
before?
An X still. Like, it's embarrassing. It needed to be like a I guess. 8? No, I don't even know where that is in line. I don't care about phone quality, clearly.
Yeah, me either.
But I was getting bullied, so I finally was like, okay, I'm going to do it. You know what? The trolls won. And I'm fine losing that because I did need a new phone.
Yeah, you're a content creator. Come on.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, it's my job. I'm out $1,200 and the trolls have won, but that's okay with me.
So you're saying haters do get to you.
In that specific situation, 100%. In any other situation, not really. You know?
Dang, I go back and forth.
Yeah. Sometimes if I'm in a more vulnerable position or if I'm more uncertain about things in my life, I think it'll bother me more. It really depends on where I'm at that time.
And it's up and down.
Yes.
Us as creators, as entrepreneurs, every week is so different.
It is so different. I want to talk a little bit about growth on social media because you're killing it, specifically on TikTok. So we're going to go through platforms.
Oh, thank you.
What are your best tips for growth on TikTok?
Oh, man. I'm actually not that good at this.
No, yes, you are. Have you seen your TikTok?
I'm not that good. I actually, oh man, I don't even know any tips on TikTok.
You're consistent.
I try to be, but I take weeks off. I was killing it last year at this time. I would get like a million views. I took 3 months almost off TikTok, yeah, or like trying. My biggest tip on TikTok is to watch TikTok videos. Yes. You have to put in so many hours to TikTok because you actually have to see what's trending. Mm-hmm. And to go viral, you have to watch TikTok for at least an hour a day. It's literally, the app sucks you in. But yeah, I will say, my biggest app, which people have no idea about, is Snapchat. By far. Oh. My biggest following is on Snapchat, and I'm obsessed with Snapchat. I do so much there. And if no one's been on Spotlight yet, you have to be on Spotlight.
I have heard about Spotlight because people were making so much money, yeah, off of it.
Oh, yeah. You can make money. I've made money off Spotlight.
Okay, wait. Let's go into Spotlight. Explain yeah, this to me.
Because TikTok to me is like, everyone talks about like, oh, here are my TikTok tips. No one really is touching Snapchat right now, yeah, and in Spotlight as much or talking about it. I just honestly can't say enough about Snapchat. I think if you're consistent about it and if you post, by the way, nothing's on my Snapchat for the last 4 days, so I need to get on it. So basically what I do is I try to go in camera. You have to film in the app in the Snapchat. It's stop reposting for your Instagram stories. Okay. And do it in the app at least like 3 to 4 frames a day. They have added music that you guys can add. You have hashtags. It's Snapchat, I don't want to compare it to TikTok, but it is becoming like a TikTok. So the trending videos and sounds and stuff, they have your own original sounds. And you guys, I'm pretty sure, I don't want to just like make this up, but I knew that they were doing this a few months ago in November. They're giving away $1 million a day.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I heard, I think it was on like David Dobrik's podcast like maybe 6 months ago, them yeah, talking about this kid who was making like $1 million a week or something.
I don't know if they're still doing it, okay, but I do know that they're still giving away money. So basically what I mean by this, if you guys post a video and it goes viral, just like it does on TikTok, and you have no idea what's going to go viral or not, so why not post? Uh-huh. Basically, you can win money. So I posted one video that had, I think, 750K views, which on TikTok, I would probably make $5. And on Snapchat, I made $3,000.
Yeah.
So,
and it's just random.
It's like, honestly, like free money to me.
Yeah.
And so try Snapchat, you guys. Why not post?
I'm about to be in her car. We're driving to Santa Monica after this. I'm literally going to be like, I'm on Snapchat. I just now I'm back on Snapchat for the first time in yeah, years, but just as like my personal hometown account. Like I don't
keep
use
doing it.
But I don't use it for like Kenzie Elizabeth stuff. So I need to get need back to. On it in that way.
You need to do have a public Snapchat so okay, anyone can follow you on there and just start posting every day. Because
are you posting meals and workouts?
Meals and workouts. Okay. Brands are starting to take hold of Snapchat as well. Okay. So I would say about a year ago, I didn't see any brand revenue. I would only see it through Instagram and now TikTok too. Now in the next year, I'm telling you, 2022, brands are going to be on Snapchat.
Well, it's interesting that you say that's this now. I was the other day thinking about how I should have jumped on TikTok from the start and I didn't. And I'm like, then I will not miss the next app. I will not miss the next platform.
No, I think it's Snapchat. I really, really okay, and I know Snapchat's already huge and Snapchat.
But they kind of died out for a while too. And there's yeah, been a resurgence recently.
I completely agree with you. Okay, so perfect. That's my biggest tip on social media and growing right now.
What about Instagram?
Instagram is way too freaking hard to grow on Instagram right now.
Everyone says it's literally impossible. It's impossible.
I've literally stayed at the same following. The only reason I went up about 4K recently is because I did a Snapchat giveaway. I said, go follow yeah, me on Instagram.
Yep.
And they did.
So it's Snapchat. So it's okay, Snapchat.
Honestly, all the people that follow me on Instagram are like my Snapchat followers now.
Wow.
And it's been impossible to grow on Instagram. I lose 1,000 followers a day on Instagram.
It's awful. I have friends yeah, who've lost like hundreds of thousands at this point.
And I don't even know why. Yeah. I post the same shit.
It's weird. It's really weird.
I give really good workouts. Today I did a 7-minute free abs routine and I lose followers.
It's I don't so get it. Weird.
You know why I think though? I think it's because Instagram is really trying to take away
the bots.
The bots, A, but also, you know how we make money off an Instagram post? It's like you hold up a bottle and yeah, it's like, buy this. They want us to utilize the shop feature on Instagram. So whoever's using the shop feature, it's always the new feature that pushes you up.
Well, I all of a sudden was growing again when they were pushing reels.
Yeah.
And I was growing like crazy on Instagram compared to what I normally do. And then the algorithm changed again to whatever saved. I'm so tired
over
of
it.
Like, I'm so sorry. I know this is my full-time job, but Instagram is not my full-time job. No. Just keep it the same for maybe 6 months. That's all I'm asking.
Completely agree. And it's absolute bullshit. I'm going to just rail on Instagram right here for a sec because how do they not want us to make money? That's how
it's insane.
That is how we make money. So for you to take away the algorithm for influencers, followers is really stupid because they're pushing for themselves to get more money. And by the way, Facebook and Instagram, you don't need more money. So when you use that shop feature, they're pushing out the shop feature because that way they make a cut of it. It's bullshit. It really is.
It's so stupid.
Yeah.
Do you have any YouTube tips? No, I feel the same way. It's just, it's so exhausting. I love the Instagram team and I love all of them. It's not them personally.
No,
it's just the, like, what are you? Yeah. Oh my God. It's just, I'm tired.
No. And I'm very thankful for Instagram. It's how I make most of my money. And,
but still
like,
that's why you care. So that's why it hurts so much. You know, it really hurts.
My YouTube stuff? Yeah. No, you would have better, way better.
No, I haven't grown on YouTube in like 3 years.
I have no tips for YouTube.
I have no tips either at this point. No idea. I've really given up. I actually like, am just, I think with YouTube, I like where I'm at. I like what I post and do. And I'm not necessarily going to go make like the next viral YouTube video. That's not really my thing. Yeah. But I think with social media, and it's something I remind myself of all the time, like my end goal isn't to be like this viral YouTuber necessarily. Not that I wouldn't want to grow, but I don't, and it's not anything against YouTube. Like YouTube is my main thing. That's my platform. That's where I came from. But it's like, I'm not looking to make like a certain type of YouTube video necessarily, you know? Also, but like long-term, whatever I want to do, it's still going to come from this. You know what I mean? So I'm okay with where I'm at and like staying true to myself on that platform, but I can't fake it. And that's what hurts me on YouTube.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people can and I can't.
No, I feel you. A lot of people grow on YouTube. I know a lot of girls who just grow fitness channels on YouTube really fast because it's burn 100 calories, lose weight, get this six pack, lose your hip dips, which you can't fucking do. So, and I will never title my videos that. Like, the titles and the of some of these fitness videos are just like, I can't pick myself to do that. I will say, if we're talking about like tips and stuff, newsletter. I just started a newsletter and I think it's the safest bet that anyone in our industry can do.
I recently did this and I agree with what you're going to say. I already know.
Because you can lose every social media platform.
You can't lose your mailing list.
You can't lose a mailing list, and that's how you sell product.
Yes. Well, I was pretty good about it for a while, and then I've kind of been off, and the girl who like runs my socials for the podcast, recently I was like, this is what we're doing. We're going back to newsletter because it is so crazy. I actually had a call with these people who are like a totally different industry. And I was confused as to how their business was so successful because they didn't have a massive social following either. Yeah. But I'm like, I know you guys sell like 40,000 units. I know your sales. So I'm confused on where the sales are coming from. All newsletter. They're like, oh, we don't even, what they're like, what we focus on, it's probably 80% newsletters over social media even.
Yeah.
I was like,
it's
crazy
because you can really target an audience and you can see the click-through rate as well. And so if you're trying to get into anything right now, I would say Snapchat and newsletters.
Okay. Well, I'm glad that we're driving together because I will literally, I'm literally making a new public Snapchat right now as we speak, guys.
Do it.
Very exciting.
I encourage everyone to do it.
I'm trying to think of anything else. We've talked so much. What I do want to end off on with you, I want drinking hacks because you love drinking. I love drinking. I hate hangovers. I think back often to when I was, I shouldn't even say that I was underage, but when I was young and I didn't experience these things. What do you do? Like, what's your like drinking routine?
Okay. Actually, I'm so happy you just asked me this because meanwhile, I'm like drinking a sparkly drink right now. I'm trying to burp. Super cute. Okay. So I've been drinking a lot lately because I've had my best friends come visit. And so unfortunately, I've been drinking a lot. And so basically last weekend, I had like maybe three or four drinks and they're all like margaritas or like a sangria. And the next day I was so hungover that I could not move. This weekend on Saturday, I probably had like eight drinks over the course of a lot of hours, everyone, a lot of hours. And they were all tequila sodas. And in between each tequila soda, I had a glass of water.
You know what's crazy?
I was fine the next day.
You're going to love this. I was at a bar this weekend. I had just seen your TikTok and I drink margaritas and ranch waters, which ranch water.
Yes.
Okay. So I say that to people and people are like, what is that? Because I guess
ranch water is it.
It's such a Texas thing, but it's Topo Chico and tequila for those who don't know. But yeah, I was drinking out and I said, wait, excuse me, I need a water. And I was thinking about your TikTok, I'm like, a water in between my drinks.
Yes. I did it. I did that. And I swear to you, I should have been so hungover on yesterday, on Sunday. And I wasn't. I was like, wait, this is so weird. The one thing that I did was no sugary drinks, like not 1 ounce of sugar in my tequila soda, extra lime. That's it. And then water in between everyone.
That's what I need to do.
Let me tell you, I peed a lot.
Yeah, that's the only thing that sucks. I have a Hydro Jug. They're actually a sponsor on the podcast. But it's a half gallon of water. Oh, and I will literally fill up a half gallon of water. I'll put 3 liquid IV packs in there because it's so much water. And I get home. It doesn't matter if it's 3 a.m. and I chug the entire thing. And it doesn't matter if I had one drink. I'm very extreme because I can't risk it. I wake up feeling fine.
Yeah.
Another thing is I will literally schedule Smoothie King to be delivered to my house at 8 a.m. the next morning. And wow, that actually really helps too.
So brilliant.
Oh, I'm very efficient with it. Like my drinks, like my water and my pajamas are laying out and I do my whole skincare routine.
That is amazing. I need to get on that level.
It's really good. But no, you had another thing. What, there was like vitamins or something to take, right?
Okay, so I'm not a doctor, just an FYI, but I take some digestive enzymes. I also take this thing called alpha lipoic acid, and if anyone actually is listening, this one's like, oh my gosh, she pronounced it wrong, I'm really sorry. But basically what it does is you take it about 30 minutes before you drink, and it helps metabolize the sugar and alcohol.
Okay.
I might be totally wrong. This is what one of my nutritionist friends told me, and so I've been taking it, and it's been I guess helping. Also, I get really, really bad heartburn, and so the digestive enzymes just really help with that, so I can keep drinking.
Love it.
And then vitamin C. I take vitamin C, okay, because your immune system is run down when you're drinking and you're like around so many people. So you always want to make sure you're taking vitamin C either before or after you go out. And yeah, hydration is key.
Whatever you said, that was the word that was hard to pronounce. That must be what Party Smart is or whatever. The pill at Whole Foods. I used to get this a lot too. And we would just take it 30 minutes before we drank. But it was like branded, so yeah. I know exactly what it was. And I'm not asking questions. If it's going to help me, sure.
No, totally. You know? 100% same. That's a huge branding point. Yeah. Good job on their branding.
Yeah, that's actually, I'm like, I don't even know what it is, but that must be it.
Oh, and another one, milk thistle. Again, I don't know if I did that correctly, but it helps your liver because we drink so much in our 20s and in college. If you're listening to this, milk thistle, because your liver needs a vitamin.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
I'm going to Amazon all this stuff.
Yes.
It'll be ready for you when I get home.
Yeah, exactly.
Love it. Okay, well, thank you so much for coming on. Where can they find you?
Oh, everyone can find me just at Katie Austin and the Katie Austin app for all my follow-along in-home workouts.
Love.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Thank you, guys. You're so you won't believe. It's who you see. I'm clinging to my sanity. I'm too